Good morning.
Good morning.
It is good to see you on this beautiful day as we have gathered in this place to worship, to fellowship, to commune, and to share with God the gifts that He has given us. It is indeed a pleasure to welcome you, and we have many guests with us this morning. It is a special time of worship and a special time of celebration. Today is our Graduate Sunday as we recognize those students for their accomplishments and congratulate them and recognize them and share with our family all that they have done. If you are visiting with us today, we're glad you're here. And I want to take an opportunity and I want to ask everybody to stand and look around. If you see somebody you haven't talked to this morning, take 2 seconds, run to them and say, hey, stand up and greet them.
join me in prayer. Lord, we come into your house today. We do not forget that. We invite the Holy Spirit to fill this time, fill this place, this time of worship, as we recognize some graduates today, but ultimately we recognize you as we worship you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may now be seated. I can invite my two scripture readers for the day, Ricky and Blake. If you would like, you can turn to 2 Kings chapter 5. Now Naaman, captain of the host of the king of Syria, was a great man with his master and honorable. Because by him the Lord had given deliverance unto Syria. He was also a mighty man in valor, but he was a leper. And the Syrians had gone out by company, and had brought away captive out of the land of Israel a little maiden, and she waited on Naaman's wife. And she said unto her mistress, "The God my Lord were with the prophet that is in Samaria, for he would recover him of his leprosy." And one went in and told his Lord, saying, "Thus and thus said the maid that is of the land of Israel." And the king of Syria said, go, and I will send a letter unto the king of Israel. And he departed, and he took with him 10 talents of silver, and 6,000 pieces of gold, and 10 changes of raiment. And he brought the letter of the king unto Israel, saying, "Now when this letter is come unto thee, behold, I have therewith sent Naaman, my servant to thee, that thou mayest recover him of his leprosy." And it came to pass, when the king of Israel had read the letter, that he rent his clothes, and said, "Am I God to kill, to make alive, that this man doth send unto me, and recover a man of his leprosy? Or wherefore I consider, for I pray to you, and see how seeketh a quarrel against me."
Starting in verse 8 of the same chapter, it reads, "And it was so, when Elijah the man of God had heard that the king of Israel had rent his clothes, that he sent to the king, saying, 'Wherefore hast thou rent thy clothes? Let him come now unto me, and he shall know that there is a prophet in Israel.' So Naaman came with his horses and with his chariot, and stood at the door of the house of Elisha. And Elisha sent a messenger unto him, saying, 'Go, and wash in Jordan 7 times, and thy flesh shall come again unto thee, and thou shalt be clean.' But Naaman was wroth, and went away, and said, 'Behold, I thought he will surely come out to me, and stand and call on the name of the Lord his God, and strike his hand over the place, and recover the leper. Are not Abana and Pharpar rivers of Damascus better than all the waters of Israel? May I not wash from them and be clean?' So he turned away in a rage. And his servants came near and spake unto him and said, 'My father, if the prophet had bid thee do some great thing, wouldest thou not have done it? How much rather then, when he saith unto thee, wash and be clean?' Then went he down and dipped himself 7 times in Jordan, and according to the saying of the man of God, and his flesh came again unto the flesh of a little child, and he was clean."
Yeah. No, I'm no expert in rocks, but if there was one science that I actually paid attention to in school, it was earth science. What I can tell you is rocks are different. They're different based on how they are formed. Some take years to develop fully, some form gradually, some sparkle, some are small, some are huge, but all form under pressure. What appears on the outside of the rock may not always be what's on the inside. Rocks serve a variety of purposes. If we stop to think about it, they are a staple and cornerstone for so many things in life that more often than not, we take for granted. We also tend to overlook rocks' true value. If we're honest, most of us equate rocks with strength and stability. Throughout Scripture, rocks are commonly referred to as a symbol of God's reliability. The Bible advises that we build our houses and lives upon a stable rock that is God's love, wisdom, and salvation. Rocks are interlaced with the idea of refuge and a place to escape the hardships of this world. 1 Corinthians 10:4 reads, "And drink the same spiritual drink, for they drank from the spiritual rock that accompanied them, and that rock was Christ." 1 Peter 2:4 reads, "As you come to him, the living stone, rejected by humans, but chose by God and precious to him." 1 Samuel 2:2, "There is no one holy like the Lord. There is no one besides you. There is no rock like our God." Isaiah 51:1, "Listen to me who pursue righteousness and who seek the Lord. Look to the rock from whom you were cut." Psalm 18:2, "The Lord is my rock, my fortress, and my deliverer. My God is my rock, in whom I take refuge, my shield, and the horn of my salvation, my stronghold." Psalm 62:6, "Truly, he is my rock and my salvation. He is my salvation, I will not be shaken." These are but a few of the references to rocks you will find in Scripture. If you read and research, you will find so much more. Those of you who were given a gemstone represent the rocks in the lives of these graduates. And we, like the three types of rocks, have three rocks in our lives we want to recognize today. First, the cornerstone in the bedrocks of our lives, those that came up here today. You are the ones who took the sand and the sediment, the molten lava, and all that lie underneath, and endured the years of pressure as each of these gemstones that stands before you was formed. With the guidance of our Lord and Savior, you served as their earthly rock, the one who laid the foundation for all it is and all will come next. You cultivated your heart, your mind, and endured the growing pains. Without you, all they had built, all they set out to do and achieve would merely crumble to the ground. Take this rock that they made you as a reminder of the rock you have been, the rock you are, and the rock you will continue to be in their lives. Your love, sacrifice, and support has paved the way for a mighty work. You took the elements from God, and you cultivated it into a strong and mighty force. Blake, you said that you would give this. The second rock is our rock of truth. Herding cats is not an easy task. As a youth minister, at times it can seem that is exactly what you're doing. But anyone who's ever owned more than one cat knows that cats can be taught, trained, and yes, even herded. It takes patience, love, time, and a lot of neosporin. But in the moments when those cats become mighty lions, you truly see the power of the Holy Spirit to be able to touch the lives of young people, no matter how long or how brief, is truly a blessing. These graduates have been gifted with the knowledge of truth, which is Jesus Christ, and Scripture, and you, Ron, are that earthly rock that dedicated yourself to that task. You were a rock that stood firm in helping them assure that once their earthly foundation no longer exists, their heavenly home awaits. May these rocks give you, they give you, each one put a rock that was signed or had a message in the basket. Remind you of the lives you touch. Luke 6:48 reads, "They are like a man building a house who dug down deep and laid a foundation on rock. When a flood came, the torrent struck
that house but could not take it because it was well built. And may these rocks remind you each one is a young person whose foundation you rely. And finally, our third rock. Alyssa's going to present it. Is our rock of support. There is always a need when you are dealing with young people. And for us, we have one rock we can always count on. No matter what the task, the challenge, the trip, the endeavor, Jenny, you have always been. Without question, complaint, without doubt, fear, or hesitation, you have always been there. Like a rock, you stand boldly and strong. Never asking for recognition or glory, you merely do what you do. There isn't one of these graduates who doubts your compassion, your support, your dedication, or your love. They know you would go out of your way for them, and they know they can count on you. Each one signed this rock, or a message. You are loved and appreciated more than any words or gesture can ever capture. Your example has preached a louder message than any sermon ever could. And you have solidified for all of us what being a man of God and walking in the steps of Jesus truly means. May this rock serve as a reminder of the countless foundations you have strengthened and the endless love we have for you, as you truly are our earthly rock of support. At this time, let's give all of our rocks the And another use for it is in rock climbing, which refers to the first piece of protection, which is also called nuts, placed on a pitch. Because it has to be placed, because after your first one, the outward pull and the zipper, if it comes loose from the bonnet anchor, it's called Jesus nut. Because guess what happens? Same thing. You're going to have to pray really hard to Jesus, or you're going to meet him on the way down. More recently, in generic engineering, not aerospace or mechanical, the concept has widened to include any single component of system failure that would cause catastrophic failure for the whole system. In other words, if that doesn't work, if this breaks, they call it the Jesus nut because there's nothing that's going to save it. Now, Colossians tells us that he is before all things, and in him all things hold together. So you know what that means? You have a Jesus nut in you. When you accepted Christ as your Savior, guess what? That nut is in you. You don't have to wait for a catastrophic failure to reach out and pray to him. You don't need something to hold you. He's what holds you together. So this is what I'll give this to remind you to check your Jesus nut every day. And all you have to do that is to reach out and say a prayer. Hey, Jesus, first thing you should do in the morning is check your Jesus nut. When you're riding down the road, you can check your Jesus nut. When you're out in public, you can check your Jesus nut. When you're having a good day, you can check your Jesus nut. So this gift is given to you to place it where you can see it. Place it where it'll remind you. Did I check my Jesus nut today? Maybe on your key ring, maybe on in your car, on your visor. Don't wait until you have a catastrophe or an accident. Do it every day. That's what it's there for. And you guys know I could probably sit here all day long and tell stories about all sorts of things. Because you guys are my heart and have been for years. But each of you know I love you. Love you so very much. And I'm always there for you. Graduation is just another thing we did together. So I want you to watch this video and remember. They're gonna play.
Going?
No.
No? Yeah? Oh. Wait, are you looking? Are you excited?
Yes.
Are you excited?
Yes.
Oh, I can see the excitement.
It's been a long road. Getting from there. Cause I
I would invite you to stand as we sing hymn number 185. Ushers, if you will please come forward. We're only going to sing the first verse of Jesus Loves Me. May we stand as we sing.
Thank you. Lord, may our hearts receive your word. Give all of our attention. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Before I start, I said I did not know about that, and I truly, truly appreciate it. That is a priceless gift, especially the one that was signed in your best to you. So, yeah, Nick gave it away. There he is. Today's title of the sermon is Keep It Simple. It's not often that I get to force people to listen to my favorite joke, but today's a good opportunity. Bill and Bob are working in a hole. They've heard this joke more than one time. Bill said to Bob, "Bob, I don't get it. We're down here slaving away in the hot sun, and the supervisor's up there under that tree drinking his iced tea in the shade." And Bob said, "I don't know, Bill. Why don't you go ask him about it?" And Bill said, "Okay, I think I will." He started to climb out of the hole, and Bob was sort of taken back. Bill goes over to the supervisor, and the supervisor sees him coming far off. He says, "What can I do for you, Bill?" Bill gets up there and says, "Well, sir, I just don't get it. We're out there in the hot sun, working all day. You're in the shade of this tree, drinking your iced tea, and you're getting paid more than us. Can you explain that?" And the supervisor looked at Bill and said, "Well, Bill, it's something called stupidity." Bill said, "Stupidity? What's that?" The supervisor thought for a second and said, "Bill, I want you to punch my hand as hard as you can." He said, "Are you sure about that?" So the supervisor held his hand out in front of the tree and said, "Yeah, swing away, Bill." Sure enough, Bill goes to punch his hand, and the supervisor moves it, slams it into the tree, and hurts his knuckles. He's thinking, "Ah." And the supervisor looked at him and said, "Bill, do you understand now?" Bill said, "Yeah, I think I do." He goes back down, and Bob's like, "Hey, Bill, what'd he say? What'd he say?" Bill said, "Well, Bob, it's something called stupidity." Bob's like, "Stupidity? What's that?" Bill says, "Bob, I want you to punch my hand as hard as you can." Bob says, "Are you sure?" He says, "Yeah." He looked around, he didn't see a tree, so he held his hand up in front of his face and said, "Swing away, Bob." Who's ever heard of the acronym KISS? K-I-S-S. Keep it simple. Does anybody know what the last one says? Y'all said it, not me. But keep it simple, stupid. That means keep it simple. There's many applications for that acronym. In so many different ways. Today we're going to look at the Word of God and see how that applies. And we're going to look at the story that was read. Thank you, Ricky and Blake, for reading that, the story of Naaman. We're going to apply how we can keep it simple, because Naaman was in the pursuit of something. We've all graduated. We've all finished one step of something. But we're not done. We don't hang it up at that. We graduated for a purpose. Rarely do people really want just a piece of paper. They actually want the next step. Whether that enables them, through whatever degree it was, just high school or college, master's, or even doctorate, they're looking for the next step. They're in pursuit of something. Naaman was in pursuit of something. Naaman had leprosy, and he wanted to be healed. He was looking for his next step. I'm going to look at this story and see three mistakes that Naaman made. The first one is this. Naaman believed money would aid him. I want you to go ahead and flip your Bibles open, if you don't have it yet, to Ecclesiastes chapter 2. Ecclesiastes chapter 2. I'll be referencing the King's story, but for a second, I want you to stay in Ecclesiastes chapter 2. Psalm, Proverbs, Ecclesiastes. While you turn there, I'm reminded of a story in Acts. Simon the sorcerer. This is in Acts chapter 8. Simon the sorcerer was seeing what the apostles were doing. And they were out, and people were getting saved, and Simon himself believed. He was a believer as well. And he saw that they laid their hands on somebody and gave him the gift of the Holy Spirit. And it says this in Acts chapter 8, when Simon saw that through the laying on hands, the apostles had given, the Holy Ghost was given, he offered them money, saying, "Give me also this power, that on whomsoever I lay hands, he may receive the Holy Ghost." But Peter said unto him, "Thy money perish with thee, because thou hast thought that the gift of God may be purchased with money." You see, the first thing Naaman did on his way was load up his horse and his chariot. And it says this in verse 5. "And he took with him 10 talents of silver, 6,000 pieces of gold, and 10 changes of raiment." Naaman was on his way to get the gift of God. They said, "Hey, there's a prophet in Samaria. And he has the gift of God. And so Naaman went and he said, well, I want that gift of God. The first thing I'm going to do is load all of my money for my changes, go all of my possessions to go purchase this gift of God. So the first mistake Naaman makes in his pursuit was that he trusted his money, or he believed that his money would aid him. Now you're in Ecclesiastes chapter 2, and we turn there for a reason. Ecclesiastes was written by Solomon. He's an old man, a very old man at the end of his life. And God gave him a gift of wisdom, and you can listen to his wisdom, and you can follow his wisdom, but he didn't follow his own wisdom. It's not that his advice was bad, he just didn't follow it. And here in Ecclesiastes, you have a man that pursued everything. And the first thing he pursued, he said in chapter 2, verse 1, it says, I said in my heart, go to now, I will prove thee with myrrh, therefore enjoy pleasure. And behold, this also is vanity. The first thing Solomon wanted in his pursuit, he said, was happiness, myrrh, the things that brought him happiness. He says, well, you know, don't I have a right to be happy? And he said, this is vanity. There, he also, after that, in verse 3, says, I saw my heart to give myself unto wine. Some people pursue drugs or alcohol, and that's their pursuit in life. After that, you read about all of his possessions. It says, I made me great works. I built me houses. I planted me vineyards. I made me gardens and orchards, and I planted trees and all of them of all kinds of fruit. I made me pools of water to water therewith the wood that bringeth forth trees. He had more possessions. He says, I got me servants and maidens and servants born in my house. I also had great possessions of great and small cattle of all that were in Jerusalem before me. This is a man who had all of the possessions. Money. Money was another one of his pursuits. In verse 8 it says this, I gathered me also silver and gold and peculiar treasure of kings and provinces. He sought after money. This is a man that sought after happiness, alcohol, possessions, money, even entertainment. If you finish it, verse 8, it says this, I got me men singers and women singers and the delights of sons and men as musical instruments and that of all sorts. Sought after entertainment. That was his pursuit. The next verse, it says, so I was great. I underline that. So I was great was his statement. And increased more than all that were before me in Jerusalem. And also my wisdom retained with me. See, that last statement is he pursued after success. He wanted success. That was his next step. He said, if I can't get it through happiness, alcohol, possession, money, entertainment, and success, I will be great. I'll be greater than anyone else was. And he said, I was great. This is Solomon, a man gifted with wisdom that people came far and wide to see. This is one man that literally had everything and anything that he wanted in his pursuit. Read verse 10, it says this, and whatsoever mine eyes desired, I kept not from him. Wow. Doesn't that seem like the life of the flesh? Imagine if you could have whatever you sought. If you had enough resources and assets and possessions, that if you saw it, it was yours. You think, doesn't that sound like a great life? Isn't that part of the pursuit? We just want to be happy, right? We just want to have money, right? Possessions, entertainment. You think, well, what happened to Solomon? And don't miss this. Verse 17, therefore, I hated life. Therefore, I hated life. In your pursuit, in your next step, you may think, well, hey, I just want to get a good job and have lots of money. You know, I want to go for the best paycheck I can get. You're going to hate your life. You think, well, I just want entertainment. I just want to go to these concerts and stuff like this. I just want to enjoy what's around me through entertainment. You're going to hate your life. You think, well, what about happiness? Don't I have the right to be happy? See, I understand what the Bible says, but I just want to be happy, right? Can I just be happy? I know what God says about fornication and all that, the covenants of marriage and adultery, but don't I have the right to just be happy? You are going to hate your life. Solomon pursued after all of these things. And at the end he said, therefore, I hated my life. It's like a person that tries to build a ladder with all of these rungs in it, and they're plugging them in one after another thinking, I've got to get the next promotion. This isn't good enough. I'm not satisfied with what I have. I want to go somewhere for my own benefit. I've worked a hard day. It's all about me. It's the self-life. And they build this ladder together with these rungs, and they try to hold on to it as they're climbing up. But in order to get to God, And God's standing back, looking at the person who built the ladder and says, you're only 10 feet off the ground. And that's the height you've attained through a life of wasted vanity. Solomon started by saying, also all is vanity, meaningless. You see, Christ flipped everything upside down in pursuit. He said, if you want to be the greatest, you have to be the least. If you want to be a king, you have to be a servant. If you want to be the first, you have to be the last. And if you want to reach heaven, then you've got to plant your feet on solid ground, which is Christ Jesus our rock. Christ flipped what the world says is the pursuit of happiness. So the first thing Naaman did when he went, so we might not be doing this in a pursuit of ourselves. We might think, oh, well, I'm doing this to pursue God. You know, if I had a better job, I could tithe more. If I had a higher position, I'd have more time to go to church. These are the things that I'm going to pursue in order to pursue God. You see, Naaman was in pursuit of God. He wanted the gift of God, and he relied on his riches, that first mistake. He relied on his possessions to get it. The second mistake he made was that he also relied on people and reputation. And when Naaman delivered all these things, he was told to him in verse 3 that there was a prophet in Samaria. And so what did he do? He took all of his stuff and he brought the letter to the king of Israel. Was that the prophet? No, I want to go to the best person I can. Okay, there's a prophet in Samaria. Surely the king will be the one to heal me. He gives the letter saying, hey, I brought all this stuff. Heal me. And it came to pass when the king of Israel had read the letter, this is verse 7, he said that he rent his clothes and said, am I God to kill and make alive? You see, Naaman thought, okay, I have all this money. That's mistake number one. And now I'm going to go to the right person. That's mistake number two. See, in your next pursuit, whatever it may be, don't fall into the trap Naaman did, where he wanted to go to the next person. Well, if I know the boss, I'll be good. Well, if I know this CEO, I'll be good. Hey, I just want to climb up the ladder so that I can be associated with so-and-so or with so-and-so or this person has my back. Let me tell you the truth. When push comes to shove, they will save their own neck. The king said, who am I? I'm not God. This man quarrels against me. Why? Because he knew he couldn't heal him. He knew he couldn't fulfill what Naaman desired. And so he immediately rejected him. And the same will happen. If you rely on people, they will reject you. If you rely on anyone other than God, they will reject you. 1 Corinthians. But also, we remember that just like in the first pursuit, sometimes we say, oh, well, we're doing this for God. We're pursuing God. I'm not relying on people. I'm trying to get to God like Naaman was as well. And so what we'll do is we'll flip open, hey, the brightest new commentary, or listen to the best preacher on TV, or, oh, this person says, or this person says, and all these people say, and we go to all the other wisdom of the world to figure out the gift of God, rather than going to the Word of God in that time, which Hebrews 1 says was the prophets. 1 Corinthians 3:19, 21 says this, for the wisdom of this world is foolishness with God. For it is written, he hath taken the wise in his own craftiness. And again, the Lord knoweth the thoughts of the wise, that they are vain. Therefore, let no man glory in men. See, rather than going to the Word of God, which is the prophet, Naaman went to a person. Rather than flipping open your Bible, you have to turn on the TV to figure out what it says. You have to turn on the radio to figure out what it says, rather than going straight to the source. That's mistake number two that Naaman made in his next step. He relied on people. And then the last mistake he made is a grievous one. It is the worst that you can make. This mistake will not just destroy your body, it will destroy your soul. Naaman's last mistake was this. Pride. Naaman's pride nearly destroyed him. See, in the latter part of the story, he goes to Elijah, and Elijah sent a messenger and said, go wash in the Jordan before we heal. And it upset Naaman. There are greater rivers in the Jordan. The Jordan's actually a pretty muddy river, if you've ever seen it. There are greater rivers that I could go to. See, it was Naaman's pride. He came all that way, and Elijah didn't want his gold, didn't want his raiments. It wasn't about the king. And Elijah didn't even come out of his house to meet him. It said, and Elijah sent a messenger to go tell him, hey, go wash in the Jordan. And Naaman's pride said, it can't be that easy. See, I'm worthy of more than just washing in the Jordan to be clean. I'm someone who can go to this river or climb that mountain and I'll do it. And his servant knew it and his servant told him that. He said, look, if the prophet had told you to do this great task, you would have done it in a heartbeat. How much more so would you not do something that's easy? See, Naaman was prideful. And he thought it was on him. He thought it was about him, what he was supposed to do. And he was worthy of more than that. The reason that's so devastating is because all of these mistakes before, whether it's in happiness or pursuit of entertainment or any of those, are all external. God can take them away and humble you like that. But pride lives inside of you. And it eats inside of you. And you can have everything taken away. You can be a leper about to die and still not let go of your pride. Pride is like a mirror that you hold up. When I was in high school, when I was graduating, right around that time, I was going to a school event. I had my mirror flipped down, and I was looking into it, slammed into the back of another car, and I towed the car. See, I was staring in the mirror, and I couldn't see where I was going. Pride is the same thing. You'll hold that mirror all the way up as you walk down the steps into the gate of hell, not having a clue where you're going. And Jesus himself gives us an example of that in Matthew 7. See, there are those people that come to Jesus, and he said, hey, only few people will find the narrow and straight gate, but many people will find the wide path to destruction. And this is what he says. He says, many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name? And in thy name cast out many devils? And in thy name done many marvelous works? Me, 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 me. Look at all I've done for you, Lord. They knew the Lord. They knew his name. They called him Jesus Christ. But they lived on the merits of their own works. And they lived on the merits of what they wanted. They lived in their pride. Many people will live in that pride on the day of judgment when they die and say, Lord, Lord, did I not do all these things? See, Naaman said, I'm more worthy than something as simple as washing in the Jordan River. Well, here's the truth. It has nothing to do with us. It has everything to do with him. Some people will say, well, surely I have to make a pilgrimage to a holy land to get closer to God. Or surely I have to live a good life and turn from all my sin, and I can't sin ever again, or I'll lose it, because I've got to live a righteous life. Surely bad people won't make it into heaven. Hey, I got a newsflash for you. It's not about how good we are, it's about how good he is. It says our righteousness is but filthy rags. You see, it's really simple. If you want to be healed, believe. Jesus said, believe on me. 1 John 5:10, 11 and 13 says this, he that believeth on the Son of God hath the witness in himself. He that believeth not God hath made him a liar, because he believeth not the record that God gave of the Son. And this is the record, that God hath given us eternal life, and this life is in the Son. These things have I written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that you may know you have eternal life, and that you may believe on the name of the Son of God. John 6:47 says, verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth on me hath everlasting life. Matthew 7:21 says, not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father, which is in heaven. And what is that will? In John chapter 6, verses 35, 36, and 40, it says this, and Jesus said unto them, I am the bread of life. He that cometh to me shall never hunger. He that believeth on me shall never thirst. But I said unto you, that you also have seen me, and believed not. And this is the will of him that sent me, that everyone which seeth the Son and believeth on him may have everlasting life, and I will raise him up at the last day. Romans 10:9 says that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus Christ, hey, they did that. Don't they make the cut? They confess. They said, Lord, Lord, we did these things in your name. But what's the next part? It says, and believe in your heart that Jesus raised from the dead. Believe in your heart. John 5:24 says, verily, verily, I say unto you, he that heareth my word and believeth on him that sent me hath everlasting life, and shall not come into condemnation, but is passed from life to death. John 11:25, 26 says, Jesus said unto her, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. Do you believe this? John 3:15, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, have eternal life. John 3:18, he that believeth on him is not condemned, but he that believeth not is condemned already, because he hath not believed in the name of the only begotten Son. John 3:36, he that believeth on the Son hath everlasting life, and he that believeth not the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abide on him. 1 Corinthians 15:2, by which also you are saved if you keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless you have believed in vain. I could keep going. Let's keep going. Ephesians 1:13, in whom you also have trusted, that when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also you have believed, you were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. Romans 4:5-6, but to him that worketh not, but believeth on him that justifies the ungodly, his faith is counted for righteousness. Even as David also described the blessing of the man unto God imputed righteousness without works. John 1:12, but as many as received him, to them gave he the power to become sons of God, even them that believe on his name. Acts 19:4, then said Paul, John verily baptized with the baptism of repentance, saying unto them, they should believe on the one that is to come, and that is Christ Jesus. And then, oh, I forgot one, John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever shall live a great life, turn from all their sin, who shall I'll ever get baptized? Who shall go, go to church every Sunday? They're going to make it into heaven. No, he said, whosoever believeth on him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. You see, our hope of eternal salvation is simple. You believe. And that third mistake of pride, where you say, no, I've got to believe, but it's got to be me too. I'm way better than that person. There's no way that person's going to make it into heaven. Look how bad they are. See, I do all the works. And when you get there, you say, Lord, it was my works that I should get into heaven. If he said, why should I let you into heaven? You say, I did all these things for you. He's going to say, depart from me. I never knew you. Not I used to know you, or I knew you once. I never knew you. Because you have to fully give it to Christ in order to get it. And that's a simple thing. See, we overcomplicate things just like Naaman did in his search for God. And the last thing he said was, I'm more worthy of just washing in Jordan. Some people say, well, I'm more worthy. I am capable of living the good life, living a righteous life, than my neighbor who somehow gets salvation and just keeps on messing up. You see, it's really simple. Naaman trusted in his money. He pursued after that. Let's keep it simple. Trust in the Lord. Naaman trusted in other people. He pursued after that. Let's keep it simple. Trust in the Lord. Naaman trusted in himself. He looked at himself. Hey, let's keep it simple. Trust in the Lord. Whatever your pursuit is, whatever your next step is, from this degree, from this graduation, whatever occupation you go in, trust in the Lord. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for this word. May it guide us in our lives. May we always turn to you and trust in you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I am going to switch gears slightly and briefly present the gifts that we have. Now, this year, we've done something special, and many of y'all have seen the gifts, and if you haven't, you'll have one opportunity to make an impact in all the lives of our high school graduates here. For all of my high school graduates, we have gotten them a Bible. Now, these Bibles have been on display out in the hallway going toward the Sunday school wing, to the right of the fellowship hall if you go out. They will continue to be on display for a little bit after service. So during the benediction, when I invite all of the recessional and the graduates to go to the fellowship hall, you will have an opportunity, if you've yet to go right in their Bible or underline a verse or highlight it, you will have an opportunity to do so. This is their gift that's going to be given to them. So as they read scripture for themselves, they don't rely on the wisdom of the world, they rely on the wisdom of God. They can also see how God has directed you in your life through the verses that you underline, through maybe a note that you write to them, how it's impacted you. So please take a moment for these graduates and go write in that Bible immediately after service if you haven't had the opportunity to do so. And then after about 20 minutes or so, while they've been in the fellowship hall, those Bibles will be presented with them as they leave, and they can take it on their way. So that is the gift, plus the Jesus nut that y'all have as well. Always keep the Jesus nut on hand and with you. And then for our college and above, I always try to do something practical. I was talking with Carrie, trying to think of a really practical gift, and I was asking CJ in the office, said, what can we get that isn't just going to be like, thank you so much for this, and it gets put in a drawer, or it gets thrown away, or something like that. So I thought, I got a pretty good idea for the most practical gift we came up with. You all get a portable vacuum for your car. And so, for all my college and above, you get a portable vacuum that you get to keep in your car. And some people are like, man, I wish I had that gift. Very practical gift that'll go with you if you can use it. But the gift today is God's Word, and y'all know that. The gift is always freely given. You don't have to earn a degree to get God's Word. Matter of fact, God blesses the poorest with the most rich faith. And he uses the base things of this world to confound the wisdom of this world. And remember that. Always humble yourself. Never think you're more highly than you really are. I'll invite Doug up now to do Amazing Grace together. This will be after the conclusion of Amazing Grace. I will come up and give just a benediction prayer. Then I'll invite the graduates up. They'll walk out. And at that time, after the service is done, when all the graduates have walked out, as we applaud for them, you'll be able to go into fellowship hall, shake their hand, hug their neck, wish them well, give them good advice that they're going to remember all of their life, and then write in the Bible if you have it. Doug?
I'd invite you to stand as we sing hymn number 343. Amazing Grace, we'll sing the first and last verse. May we sing together.
For our 2019 graduates as they recess into the fellowship hall.